Hello and welcome. Today we are in our second session from Collective, co-organized with the Yugma Network on the occasion of World Environment Day 2021. Yesterday we heard from Avro Chakraborty, who's a noted rice conservationist and who spoke about how agriculture and natural degradation are connected. He also spoke about alternatives which were present and which we need to look towards if we are serious about changing the relationship between humans and nature and between humans among ourselves. From Collective, the idea of organizing this series comes from the increasingly political role that environment has taken today. Our future is at threat and it is being recognized widely. Yet the responses have been varied. 2021 to 2031 has been marked as the decade of ecological conservation by the United Nations. So June 5, Environment Day, flags off this decade. The United Nations plans to sets a goal for all nations to restore large swathes of ecosystems which have been devastated in the previous decade. However, in our own country, we are seeing a number of new projects have come up during the pandemic itself. On March 24, 2020, the Environment Ministry, in an extremely urgent video conference, allowed for several dilutions being introduced in the Environment Impact Assessment norms. After that, we have seen a number of big projects being okayed at lightning speed, one after the other. From the Mollem beach in Goa to the case of diamond mining in Madhya Pradesh to most recently the Lakshadweep islands being given up to be developed into a smart city. So with us today to speak about this new decade, the challenges before the environment movement today, all of us who are committed to an ecologically just and a socially equitable future, we have with us Nityanand Jayaraman. He's a noted conservationist and a writer, and he's a part of Vetivar Collective, which he investigates corporate abuse of environmental laws and has written and spoken extensively about the threats and challenges before us today, as well as participated in a number of people's movements. Today's conversation will be in English. Today's conversation will be in English, where for 30 to 40 minutes we'll have Niti addressing us. After that, we'll go into a discussion where we'd like to have questions from the audience today. So with that, I'd like to invite Nityanand Jain.
Hi, good evening to everybody. I am Niti Nityanand Jayaraman.
Sorry, you're audible.
All right. Maybe there's a time lag between Chennai and Delhi. Okay. So thank you very much, Shaurya, Delhi Collective, and Yugma Network for inviting me for talk on the occasion of the World Environment Day, which was yesterday and every day. The talk is on the topic of eco-restoration as if people mattered. And I'm basically going to go through a few cautionary points when we talk about eco-restoration. You know, environment is perhaps one of the most controversial topics. Everything else, it is used by the dominant communities to as a tool of oppression, as a tool of disenfranchising, of alienating resources from people who are marginalized or people who have less political power. A classical example of this is the kind of fortress-style conservation that we inherited or we borrowed from the West. These sacrosanct boundaries around protected areas, kick out the indigenous people and other forest dwellers, treat them as criminals on their own land for entering the forest, and also completely obfuscate the real reasons for the crisis that we are in, be it the crisis of deforestation, which cannot be a crisis as a result of the activities of indigenous people, but more likely to be a consequence of the lifestyles of the well-to-do, including the likes of us. As we enter the decade of eco-restoration, we're going to hear a lot of bullshit from the Ministry of Environment of different states. We don't need to specifically say that there will be bullshit coming from the Ministry of Environment in Delhi, because we haven't seen anything other than that in the last 7 years. The policies that the Ministry of Environment has been taking are better situated in the Ministry of Industries, the Ministry of Commerce, the Ministry of Coal, but not befitting a Ministry of Environment. By this, do I mean to say that the past governments have been are not guilty? No, I'm just saying that the new government takes this guilt to an extremely different level altogether. As we speak about ecological restoration, the government of India has in the last month or so announced two extremely controversial, extremely problematic schemes. One that many of you might have heard about is the Lakshadweep area, the Lakshadweep administrative reforms, and the other is the plans that the Niti Aayog has of developing, quote unquote, developing the islands in the Andaman and Nicobar, specifically the Great Nicobar Island, beach, etc. And here they have plans. In the Andaman and Nicobar Islands, we're talking about, see, the word pristine doesn't really make sense, because almost all environment, all ecosystems around the world have been influenced by the hands of men and women over generations. But the forests in Andaman and Nicobar Islands are also home to unassimilated tribes. Tribes that have managed to escape us away. And there are also other assimilated tribes who are unfortunate to have been introduced to the modern culture. These are areas that are home to native species that we may never have, that modern science discovered yet. And these are places that we should be very careful entering. Of course, there is now a controversy about the COVID pandemic's origins, whether it was in a lab or whether it was in the forest. But as a zoonotic disease, these kinds of viruses tend to escape and infect human beings and livestock, domesticated livestock, when human beings and domesticated livestock come in contact with wild populations. And that usually happens when we do development, when we build roads and when we build mines inside forested areas and bring in the chances of interaction between wild animals and plants and human society and human the domesticated animals that form part of our lives. Situation like a pandemic, where we have clearly been caught without any, we've been exposed as not being able to take care of ourselves, to be able to deal with the situation. We are still not dealing with the root causes, deforestation and land use change that brings us in contact with wild populations. We continue with our original economic model that is driven by the agenda of capital, with absolutely no modification for eco-restoration. I'll give you an example. A lot of us tend to see, beach cleanups or this whole Swachh Bharat business as a good thing to do, where we go around picking up plastic, we recycle plastic, we put plastic in the right bin, we aim right, we upcycle things, we teach our children that these are cute things to do, and feel really good that we have done our little bit for the environment. Well, there are a few problems. I mean, doing a little bit for the environment in 2021 is as good as doing nothing. Which means if the only thing you're going to do is to ride a bicycle and put on a jhola, I'm saying don't even do it. Don't bother. There's going to be a lot more than that. If you value your future, please go ahead, plant a tree, wear a jhola, ride a bicycle. But you also need to stop deforestation. You need to fight the plastics industry. You need to fight not just the coal-fired power plant coming up next to your home, but you need to fight the coal industry. You need to fight the banking system that supports it. You need to fight the governments and change the governments to listen to us instead of to listen to corporations. Why do I say this? Because eco-restoration can become another token gesture where I have renovated, I have restored the little pond in the back of my house. I have restored the house car slick. And that becomes a big issue. Everybody likes a good story. Fantastic. And how is this restoration done? In many instances that I've been seeing around, there is money taken from large corporations who are responsible willy-nilly for the state that we're in. It's put into a CSR effort to restore a lake. I think the politics of it is wrong. There's a lot of things that are wrong with that. We will talk about that in the cautionary notes that I have to share. But first, if you want to restore, then you need to commit to doing no harm. You have the Hippocratic Oath that doctors take. This first, do no harm. Before you go to cure your patients, the sick and the ailing, you have to promise, you have to sign a pact that you will not do harm. In the same way, if you're talking about healing the earth, we have to start it with an oath that we will not do harm. As things stand, it is very difficult to fulfill that oath. But having given that oath, we can try and live up to it. What does the oath mean? What does it mean when I say you cannot do harm? It basically means everything that modern economy requires us to do to improve our standard of living cannot be done, because the modern economy is premised on building, paving, laying roads, digging, evicting, bringing in new things, completely changing the land use of a certain area. When we say decade of ecosystem restoration, what is an ecosystem? An ecosystem is the living organisms in relationship with the non-living organisms. There's a biota in relation with the abiotic environment, which includes the weather, the climate, the geology, the hydrosphere, which is the water, and the cryosphere, if you're living in the Himalayas or the Arctic, which is the ice and snow-covered areas. Between atmosphere, geosphere, the lithosphere, and the hydrosphere, and the cryosphere becomes the biosphere. And if you're talking about ecosystem restoration, it means when does an ecosystem get degraded? When the relationship is disrupted. Because in this relationship, what is circling, what is cycling, are two things. One is nutrition. We take from the earth and give back to the earth. That's a cycling of nutrition. Energy. The sole source of energy is not your Badarpur thermal power plant. It is the sun. And the sun's energy is converted by plants into energy that is then used for all other purposes. The only other source comes from beneath the ground, which is fossil fuel, which is again old sun captured by old plants. You might say wind. Wind is a function of the sun. Because of differential heating, wind flows from one place to another. And so everything at the end of the day comes to sun. And it is a limitless source of energy. We barely use a small fraction of it. So let's not say there's an energy scarcity. There's a plenty of energy. We just do not know how to enjoy it. I think just yesterday somebody beautiful tweet, which I retweeted. I think it was Disha Ravi, who said, right now we could be frolicking on the beach, but we chose capitalism. That essentially is the crisis that we have. Take the example of plastics that I started with. We're currently, everybody goes around doing their Swachh Bharat responsibilities by picking up plastic from different places and bins. Thank God for the pandemic, we're not doing that nonsense anymore. But while we are trying to Swachh our Bharat one plastic bag at a time, the plastics industry is churning out 400 million tons of plastic every year. Plastics is a problem. Even the plastics industry says we have to recycle. Such a big problem. Then should the plastics industry be reducing the amount of production or increasing it? The answer is obvious. But if you look at the trend, 20 and 2050, the plastics production will quadruple from 400 million tons to 1,600 million tons. So if you're picking plastic and feeling good about yourself, just call yourself an idiot, stop doing it, and try and shut down a plastic factory or change the law of your company, of your country. As we launch into the decade of eco-restoration, let's first commit to try and redefining our economy, that we will continue to try and improve the lot of the people whose lifestyles need to be improved, whose quality of life needs to be improved, but without harming them, future of this planet. Because there are three underrepresented or unrepresented constituencies, to my mind. There might be more. If anybody else says others, please let me know and I will add them in my next presentation. First is the historically and the ongoing marginalized communities. They're marginalized for gender reasons, caste, class, a variety of different appellations. The second constituency that's underrepresented is non-human life forms. The third constituency that's underrepresented is the unborn life forms, which includes the unborn humans. The youth, fortunately, were underrepresented, are slowly trying to assert themselves, but this is absolutely not enough. More assertion, a lot more speaking out, a lot more debates among young people, and that needs to come out. So the first caution is be cautious or take care to turn off the tap, which means we need to change the way we do business. The second caution, something that kind of seems a bit counterintuitive, beware of solutions. Swachh Bharat came as a solution. You pick up your garbage, I've done my bit for the environment. Where does this garbage go? It goes to the places where the poor people live. In Delhi, you know where it goes. It goes to these large places on the way to Haryana, to Sonipat. I remember seeing a very large and really, really horrendous kind of a garbage dump that put the Chennai garbage dump to shame. And that Chennai garbage dump was one of my primary, you know, pilgrim spots for toxic tourism. And here was this Delhi thing larger than that. Is that a solution? So you clean your city, else's neighbor backyard. If you call that a solution, then I don't know what to call you. So we need to figure out how to frame our problems in such a way that our solutions actually make sense and our solutions don't end up harming somebody. There is a very famous guru, as gurus are wont to be, from Tamil Nadu. His name is Jaggi Vasudev. And he runs a foundation called Isha Foundation. A few years ago, he gave out this campaign call called Kaveri Calling. Kaveri is a river in South India flowing through Tamil Nadu, Karnataka and Kerala. For Tamil Nadu and Karnataka, it is the lifeline. And this river, it used to be a perennial river that has now run dry for a variety of reasons, including the loss of vegetation. vegetation. Not loss of trees, but loss of vegetation. Mr. Vasudev proposed that he would bring back water into the Kaveri. He would make the Kaveri flow again. Trees. How many trees? He already calculated that because he's got people who can do 142 crore trees on either bank of the Kaveri and all its tributaries. And by doing so, he promised that he would bring back water, he would bring back rain, he would do magic, he would be God by just planting trees. And you know how everybody loves planting trees. Planting trees, if you talk about environment, they'll say, oh yeah, I planted trees. How many people actually say, I planted grasses or a thorny scrub or a shrub or a vine or a creeper? Very few, because these are not considered to be environmentally good things. The only environmentally good thing is a tree. Like the only socially relevant thing is a capitalist. Everybody else is a loser. T as an ecology, diversity, and having different things where they need to be matters a hell of a lot. Trees relevant? Trees are very relevant. But trees are relevant where they're relevant. They're not relevant everywhere. You can't plant trees in Rajasthan. That would be the wrong way of doing it. Can you vegetate Rajasthan? Yes, you can, because vegetation is a lot more than trees. It includes microscopic photosynthesizing organisms. It includes grasses. It includes thorny bushes. It includes creepers and epiphytes. In different places are signature and part of ecosystems. When you have tree planting and the tree planting is seen, it's only a tree-centric approach to your what you call environmentalism, it is likely to go wrong more often than not. In a city, you can get away with it because a city is a highly degraded environment. A nuanced approach would do wonders to bring the kinds of life forms that you're supposed to enjoy the world with. Just having trees is not enough because we deserve a hell of a lot more. And so I think that when you're looking at ecological restoration, yes, it can be done in a very small bit. I'm not poo-pooing the idea of restoring your community pond. Please do it, because if there are a small group of people, a small bunch of young people, I think it's good to take a bite-sized piece of a micro ecosystem and try your hand at it. But then don't go in for corporate donations. Try and raise the money from community, because what that does is build a relationship between community and the ecosystem. And ecosystems are all about interrelationships. They are not about chains of dependencies. When I take from a corporation, it establishes a chain of dependency. I'm supposed to thank them. You don't need to be obligated. In nature, nobody thanks. They just give back. So build chains or build links of interrelationships between communities and the environment that is being healed. Caution. The issue of tree-centric environmentalism that was proposing is what I call a false solution. And these false solutions there are more false solutions than you can shake a stick at. They're everywhere. Hear somebody coming and saying, I have a solution to this problem. Just go up. The man is bullshitting, not because he's trying to fool you, but because he's been bullshitted too and he's been fooled and he's repeating it. So I have a solution is a very clear giveaway that something may be wrong, because the problems are very complex. Which problem are you trying to solve is the first question we need to ask. In Kaveri is what the flow of water. The flow of water has been affected because in the headwaters, there has been deforestation in the name of development. So transmission towers, roads, tourism, paddy lands have been lost. And all these things happen because of what we call development, which is what gives us we want. And we'll fight for it. We will jail people for it, etc., etc. So if you want water to flow, you have to address that. Water is not flowing because sand is being mined. Why is sand being mined? Because we're building our cities, and building is good. Without sand, there's no concrete. There's no concrete buildings. There's no use for steel. And if there's no steel and concrete, then your GDP goes down. So you need sand. You can either have sand or you can have Kaveri. You chose sand. You don't have Kaveri. That issue has to be addressed. The issue of pollution has to be addressed. The issue of over-extraction or mining of groundwater has to be addressed. The issue of deforestation, the removal of trees and other vegetation has to be addressed. But singling out one thing and saying, I'll plant trees everywhere, wherever it's being mined, there also I'll plant trees. Where somebody is stealing the water, I will plant trees over there. The trees are not going to take a lathi and go and catch the person who's stealing water. But that is restricted to one place. When you say 242 crores of trees along 500 meters of either bank of Kaveri and its tributaries, none of our journalists did the math. Does not add up. 242 crore trees, a few tributaries, the main channel is about 800 kilometers long. All the tributaries put together, Harangi, Kabini, Shimsha, Hemavati, Arkavati, Suvarnavati, Lokabhavani, Bhavani, Noyal, and Amravati. All these tributaries put together is another 1860. You double this because you have two banks. You multiply it by 500 meters, you get the total area. You divide the total area by so you want to plant over there, and you get a total, an absurd number of 454,887 trees per square kilometer. That works up to about 1,841 trees per acre. Even assuming that 50% of the trees die, Mr. Vasudev says about 80% of the trees survive, but we will not take that for real. Let's say 50% of them die, then we have still 900 trees in every acre of land. You know what is the tree density in Amazon? 160 to 300 trees. You come to Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu is no Amazon. We are dry, arid lands. It's brown. But brown is not ugly. Green is not beautiful. Brown is nice too. That is the color of our land. It is brown. It is red. It is green in some places. This many trees, there's more, there's three times more trees that Jaggi Vasudev wants to plant along Tamil Nadu's Kaveri than there is in Amazon. That's a rainforest. We pray for rain, cannot plant. Rivers require riverine vegetation. It requires wetlands. Can restoration be done? 100% can be done. It can be done, but for it to be done, you have to speak to homebirds who run these ridiculous numbers. You have to speak to the local farmers, the fishermen, the most unlikely people who are the holders of wisdom. False solution, and that takes me to my next issue, which is beware of experts. A very dangerous species because they have been called experts by a certain community, and these experts have never contested the fact that they are the experts. They are the only experts. And these experts usually have two or three letters behind their names, whatever. And they probably speak good English and they do PowerPoint presentations and they're called experts. But these experts, expertise is not merely a function of your education. It requires integrity and it requires courage. Second, when it comes to science, science is a way of knowing, or science is of knowing. There are different ways of knowing different things. And unless you have different ways of knowing and you are able to access these different ways of knowing, your knowledge and understanding is likely to be very limited. The experts begin when, especially with restoration, and here I have a short story to tell you about Kodaikanal, a short video to play, and then I will emphasize my point. The point about Kodaikanal is a hill town in Tamil Nadu. It's a very beautiful place up in the hills where people run to escape the summers. And in Kodaikanal in the late 1980s, before most of you were born, Very famous company called Unilever, which projects itself as the Mother Teresa of corporations. Unilever is modern bread. It manufactures, I think, Aruna ice cream, Dove soap, Fair and Lovely, that makes all you dark brothers and sisters nice and fair. This company set up a second-hand thermometer plant that was removed from America. They were trying to do a Swachh America. They removed that plant from there and sent it to Tamil Nadu, to Kodaikanal. And this plant operated for about 18, 19 years. In the process, they dumped hundreds of tons of toxic metal called mercury into the environment. Several people were poisoned. In 2001, we uncovered it. We had a campaign. We shut the factory down and thought we had won the campaign. But then we realized there were large numbers of workers who were very badly hurt and suffering. The fight for the workers' compensation, we also found that the factory environment and the Pambar Shola, which is a forest area just beneath the factory, was heavily contaminated with mercury. That had to be cleaned up. And so from 2001 to 2015, we ran a campaign, and as activists do, we do all kinds of circus to try and get attention to the issue. Until 2015, nothing much really happened. In 2015, we decided to bypass the mainstream media, which to all of you, I will tell you, it's always a good idea, as we are doing right now, and go straight to people. And we decided to tell the story in the form of a rap song called Kodaikanal Won't. You can type Kodaikanal Won't, V-O-N apostrophe T. It was sung by a good friend and a friend of the collective called Sophia Ashraf. Song went viral. Of course, we did not have much to do with that. Nicki Minaj, on whose song this song was kind of based, helped us by retweeting it. And after the song went viral, all of a sudden, Unilever discovered its corporate social responsibility within 6 months. They did what they ought to have done 16 years ago and compensated the workers. The factory site remains dirty and polluted with mercury yet. This is a company that says daag acha hai, and they remove all daags. But then over here in the factory site, they are offering to clean up to a level that would be that would consider the cleanup, the ground would be 20 times more contaminated than what is permissible in United Kingdom for houses to be set up, which means what Tamil Nadu and India is being given as a standard of remediation is 20 times worse than what other countries in the world say is safe. Experts have been called in, including people who have fiscal relationships with Unilever. And all of them have predictably said that nothing is wrong with it. The standards are great. Therein, I'm saying that you need to make sure that expert opinion is always subject to public scrutiny. These people will bend to whichever side presses them. And here, very clearly, the experts have lost their expertise, have opined on a non-scientific manner, and we are left kind of having this bill. I'll play this video very short video, but before that I would just like to see if I can conclude this, because we don't have much time, I think. Hang on, let me play the video, because I have only two more points after that. I'll play this video and then we can go on with this. So the third point that I'm making is, beware of experts. When somebody says expert has said this, right now we've been told how many experts have told how many damn different things about COVID. Do you know vaccine is good or bad? Do you know if ivermectin is good or bad? Whether Fabiflu is good or bad? Whether WHO can be believed or not? Whether health ministry can be believed or not? Everybody is an expert. Who do we believe? Bunkum. Just because Baba Ramdev is Bunkum, is Ayurveda Bunkum? There are other systems of treatment not to be considered. We are confused. But I think that in such a situation, just by saying that there is only one story is a disservice. We need to be hearing about how these different sciences or ways of knowing are interacting, what is the basis, so that we are able to make some sense out of it. the story about Unilever in a short 4-minute video.
Just because poor little rich women, we have to pay more for cleaning.
Okay. Thank you. So the last cautionary point that I have is beware of elite environmentalism. I wouldn't even call it elite environmentalism. Beware of elite aesthetics that pose as environmentalism, of restoration in the name of greening Delhi, as if green is the only color of environment. There have been in the past, clean up the city by kicking out the poor. This has happened in Delhi, it's happened in Gandhinagar, it's happened in Chennai, it's happening in Chennai. So I think that we need to be very careful that when it comes to restoration, matter of aesthetics. And even if it's a matter of aesthetics, then beauty is in the eye of the beholder. And we are a country of a very diverse set of beholders. So I think that the aesthetic sense or the other criteria that are important to different communities of people are taken into consideration when restoration is done. There is a lake called Chetpet Lake in Chennai, which was restored. Fenced off. It wasn't really restored even. It was just dug up. That's another thing. Be careful of engineers because all they know is to dig and dump. So when you ask them to restore, they call for a JCB or an earth mover because they don't know how to restore without that. And that restoration then becomes beautification because then after you restore, you have to have paddle boats in it. Then you have to have a budgie stand. Then you will have to have lawns where people can sit. And some place where you can do some really stupid things to spend your money. Now, this Chetpet Lake was quote-unquote restored like that. It was fenced off. It was a lake that fishermen, a few small fishermen were using to catch fish. It was fenced off and now it is ticketed, which means only people who have money to buy a ticket are allowed into what is a public space. This is something that we have to be very wary of because there's another way of enclosing our commons. And this is something that we have to fight very hard. If there's one thing about ecosystem restoration that we have to be very particular about, it is to ensure that ecosystems are restored, which means that it has to be common. It has to be in the commons. I will stop here so that we have some time for questions if there are any. Thank you.
And I think as we head into the decade of ecosystem restoration, some of the threats that are possible, some of the ways in which this could go wrong are something that we'll all have to be careful about. I think in the last year itself, we have seen how the call to preserve tiger forests, for example, in Assam has often become contradictory with the lives of the people, elephant roots in Assam has become contradictory with the lives of the people living there. And environment and nature has been pitted against each other. We have seen senior minister in the current union government who prides herself as an animal rights activist blame the people of Mallapuram and give it a communal anti-Muslim color when an elephant was killed last year. So all of these kinds of concerns around democracy, around social justice and around people's rights are something that will educate us during our struggles. I think one common aspect that we found between yesterday and today's session for those of us in the audience who've been attending has been how, while questioning experts, there is definitely the need for people who are doing this kind of digging, who are knowing these kinds of facts, who are rebutting these kinds of expert committees, to fuse this this knowledge, this theoretical knowledge, with the practice of people. The communities who are most directly being affected by so-called conservation efforts, as well as the worst of environmental degradation. And that, I think, is one particular place where we as students, as youth, can have a role to play. I'd like to hear your thoughts about that as well. But for those in the audience, If you have any questions or comments for Nityanand Jayaraman, please write it in the comment box. Just to start off this conversation, maybe we can go into certain instances where this kind of a fusing has happened, where people have combined the questions of democracy, of social justice, and of working people's rights in order to fight for an ecologically just future. If maybe Nithi, if you'd like to start with that, and in the meanwhile, if the rest could also leave their questions.
Okay, so if your question is, should we counter institutional expertise by posing the community science, the community ways of knowing as a counter? If that is a question, I would say, well, I mean, I think that is definitely a part of it. But what needs to be done is expertise needs to be redefined. It needs to be broadened. And the people who occupy as experts need to be held accountable. We need to call them out. We have something called the Expert Appraisal Committee in the Ministry of Environment. We have an expert committee that looks at the ecological sensitive zones and has denotified large tracts of wildlife sanctuaries in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. No expert in his or her right mind would do that. We have to call them out. We can't just say that an expert committee has done that. No. The individual scientists and say, what have you to say about this stuff? How do you defend your expertise when you have just denotified this extremely precious forest area, which is home to a large number of unassimilated indigenous people and other indigenous people in other communities, in the face of very clear evidence? It would be disastrous. Who are the people, who are the experts in the administration to Patel, who think that tourism has a future in Lakshadweep? Does Lakshadweep have a future with sea level rise? Should we not be looking at adaptation? We need to call out these people. Just as we have called Praful Patel, Praful Patel is merely the tip of the iceberg. The rot goes a lot deeper. So I think it is very important to look at the expert appraisal committees, the experts who are telling us about COVID and other things, and hold them to account. We don't have to be impolite about it, but we have to be very direct and forthright.
Discussion that we couldn't get into during your presentation. Just for the members of the audience here today, you mentioned the project happening in the Greater Nicobar Islands, which has been approved by the NITI Aayog. The so-called redevelopment project for Lakshadweep, as well as the Tuticorin People's Movement that you have also been involved in against Sterlite, which has recently been allowed to be reopened during the pandemic in the guise of ramping up oxygen production, which was widely resisted by the people and which led to a firing on protesters last year. If you could share some of your experiences as well as what we should be careful of in the future in some of these projects, and what has been the people's response so far. And I'd urge others also in the audience to jump in if they have.
So, there's even a term for it. It's called disaster capitalism, which means it's a great opportunity for the stock markets to kind of rejoice and for large corporations to make money. I think that Adani's wealth grew by an obscene amount. I don't remember the number of billions, but by an obscene amount in the 12 months where people were dying, walking back home in the hot sun, about 2,000 kilometers. But that is the nature of capitalism. When Delhi was reeling under this oxygen crisis, which was a result of poor planning and arrogance on the part of the various governments. This company called Vedanta, which used to run a very polluting copper smelter in the southern coastal town called Thoothukudi. The copper smelter ran for about 20 years, 2007 to 2018, and was shut down in May 2018 after 14 people were shot dead by the police for protesting against the company's pollution. Of course, the company's argument is we make copper, as if that justifies everything. The company was shut down. The government of Tamil Nadu locked and sealed the factory, a revolutionary act for a government that is committed to protecting large capital. The company has been running to different courts. At the High Court of Madras, the company's appeals were dismissed. And the people and the government, well, the government did not really do much of the arguing, the people did. And the lock and seal order on the company and the closure of the company was upheld. The company has now gone to pending in the Supreme Court as we speak. Now, fast forward to April 2021, massive oxygen crisis. The world can speak, India can speak about nothing but the number of the long lines for oxygen, the difficulty that people were having. It was a tragic situation in Delhi. And Vedanta comes in with an application that says, allow us to open our oxygen plant. We have an oxygen plant that has been shut down. And if you open this oxygen plant, the oxygen plant is capable of producing 1,050 tons of oxygen every day. Remember that Delhi's needs at the peak did not exceed 700 tons. This factory alone claimed to produce 1,050 tons of oxygen a day. So can you please allow us to open this plant? And then we would supply oxygen to all over the country. And this was a day before this former Chief Justice Bobde, God bless his soul, was to retire. And Mr. Bobde was all lightning and thunder and saying, oh my God, there is oxygen crisis in the world and in the country. Here's a company that is over there. Ask them to come and present before us. And government of Tamil Nadu, what do you have to say? Government of Tamil Nadu was caught between a rock and a hard place. The people of Thoothukudi were very restive. Use guns one more time. And they were very unhappy about allowing Vedanta to reopen, to open the oxygen plant. But the court did not give them any option. Say that if you don't want to open it, then we'll open it. We will ask Vedanta to open it. People need oxygen, 1 ton, 2 tons, doesn't matter. Wherever we get it from, we will take it. This is sleeping for about 8-9 months. In August 2020, Prashant Bhushan filed a case saying we need an action plan for COVID. And Mr. Bobde thought that that is not required, that the government had it under control. An action plan, because in September of 2020, there was an oxygen crisis. They need to, and in order to make up for their lapses, there's a sense of urgency. And when urgency, this is another problem with climate emergency. Once there's an emergency, people cannot speak. Shut up and listen. The court and the experts and the government knows best what's good for you. That's a dangerous situation. And that is why I think that we should not leave things to build to emergency situations. We definitely should not be calling for an emergency. The emergency is there. We need to act urgently, but do not put the hands of governments and corporations and experts that you cannot control. The Supreme Court then made it. So, long story short, the government of Tamil Nadu kind of allowed them, and the people of Thoothukudi were also what the hell? How can we stand in the way of people and their oxygen? If the company is going to produce oxygen, we have to make sure. But nobody believed that the company would actually produce oxygen. Till date, the company says they could produce 1,050 tons. It has now been April. No, May 13th was day one of production. And till date, they have produced 447 tons. In the same time, they have released into air about 4,200 tons of oxygen wasted. Okay, at the same time, till June 2nd, from May 14th to June 2nd, three states, Orissa, Jharkhand and Gujarat, have sent us by Oxygen Express to Tamil Nadu 2,000 tons for Vedanta, Vedanta's oxygen. Yes, the oxygen has come. There's a lot more that I can just paste a link for my article over here, but that is about Vedanta.
So we have a comment that's come in from Anantha, who says, in Tamil Nadu at least the question of groundwater extraction deserves a separate meet in order to find out alternatives that can supply water for daily needs. So I think we'll need to be having many more discussions like this. You mentioned the case of the Isha Foundation, but an actual solution to the problem of groundwater and what I have to also evolve.
Yeah, it is not just for Tamil Nadu. I think it's for all over the country. We need very, very strong groundwater legislations on groundwater. Even in the Gangetic Plains, it's primarily groundwater that we are, probably fossil water that we are using for our agriculture. Yeah, but very, very important.
So we are nearing an hour of this talk, and Nithi has left the link to an article about the Thoothukudi situation right now. Our audience can go and find more about it there. Just to wrap up, over the last year, we have seen a number of disturbing developments. Ecological activists, people part of the movement against climate change and other struggles to do with the preservation of the environment have been criminalized like never before. We saw the arrest of a school girl, Disha Ravi, for tweeting in solidarity with the Kisan movement, and a toolkit was used to arrest her. And in a way, a number of civil society organizations, people's movements have been criminalized, be it the firing on the Thoothukudi people or different organizations being disbanded. At the same time, we are seeing across the world new voices emerging, which are raising new kinds of solutions as well. School students, for example, have been going on strike against climate change. They have been linking with other sections of society, like workers and toiling people at large, to bring up these demands and posing more systemic questions. For example, Extinction Rebellion and the first. For questioning the system that we had gotten used to over the last three or four decades. So in this light, like you mentioned, the problems with disaster capitalism, and Disha Ravi is tweeting against capitalism. The United Nations is being forced to listen to a girl who's questioning the entire system that has been going on for so long. What do you think about these new voices coming up? What are some things that young people have to be careful about in the struggle ahead? And what are the potentials that these kinds of voices pose? Because in a way, the environment movement has had to become more political. It has always been a political issue, but now with rising attacks and criminalization, taking a side has become much more urgent. So if you could share your comments.
Okay, so to start with, I will say that I've never really been an environmental activist. I'm a social activist. The word environment doesn't really enter the struggle, because people are fighting for livelihoods, for rights, of identity, for culture. They're fighting for their link with land. It is very different. You know, environment almost makes it seem as if it's a green struggle. It's not a green struggle. It's a blue struggle. It's a red struggle. It's a brown struggle. It's a multicolored struggle. It's a struggle. And to call it green, I think, is to do disservice to the diverse points of view that people come from. So that's my first point of view. The second, I think that the clampdown is a sign that we're making a difference. Because this clampdown is not just in India, it is in Brazil. Of course, we can say that there's also a right-wing resurgence. When there's a right-wing resurgence, there will be a reaction from our side. A place like India is like we have a very vibrant culture of democracy even without knowing it, despite being from a feudal society, despite being semi-feudal even today, that go unresisted. We have the bullet train being resisted, we have the Bombay-Delhi industrial corridor being registered, we have the various dams being registered, we have the coal mines being registered, we have the Salem-Chennai expressway, the Adani port power plant somewhere else. There's a large number of resistances from the ground. The unfortunate thing is people like you and I, the middle class, the privileged, who don't have to be on the front lines, have been missing in action. We need to be, ensuring that there is solidarity, meaningful solidarity. There's a lot of meaningful solidarity that's coming in now. I think this whole Lakshadweep issue would not have made it so big if the youth of this country did not put their social media might behind the campaign and make it so large. So that is solidarity. But with solidarity comes another very important responsibility. And there I have a bit of a cautionary note. What we are seeing in the United Nations and other places is one marginalized community, which is the youth and people who represent the future generations. But within that is again the privileged that are accessing the platform. What would be useful as a kind of a guideline for all of us as solidarity workers or even frontline grassroots activists and leaders is to ensure that we are in the business of creating democratic spaces and not end up occupying those spaces that we create by ourselves. Community. You can create space and solidarity, but create spaces for the communities to speak for themselves. The experts for help with the fishing community. I cannot become an expert for the fishing community. I can become a solidarity expert who can create spaces so that a community that is not heard or visible is given the spotlight. So that is my only suggestion that, I think that we need to engage a lot more in solidarity, and meaningful solidarity means a lot more than organizing a Twitter storm. There's a lot of, small gaps that we can fill. So for instance, the collective that I'm part of is called Vetiver Collective, and there's a large, it's an organizing space for young people and others, but primarily for young people to come and understanding and complicate their understanding of society by extending or standing in solidarity with communities. And the solidarity is usually through law, science, art. And so by bringing in these aspects, I think that it is possible to, of course, there might be other ways that other people are doing it, but engaging young people with privilege in acts of solidarity would be a very valuable and meaningful thing to do.
All right, thank you for that. We have crossed 7 o'clock and we have one more question from Softil, so maybe we can wrap it up with that. Softil asks that an anti-capitalist stand is coming out from many different sections, from environmentalists to feminists to LGBTQ activists, and they're fighting in their own domains again. But unlike in the previous century, we do not have any consolidated anti-capitalist force or a vanguard. So what are the possibilities of something like this emerging? As a social activist and not an environmentalist, would you like to, do you see any kind of a possibility emerging, and where those voices can be?
Yeah, I definitely do see the possibilities of it. I mean, things like this have happened, but if you're looking for a revolution, it might not happen in the manner in which we tend to, look at revolutions, saying, it's 6 months of fight and then something happens. There will be, like ecosystems, like the planet, I think there are tipping points. And we need to be prepared to capture the moment. When that moment will come, if it will come, all these things are up in the air. That's in the realm of astrology. That is not what activists do. What we do is to ensure that there are there are channels of communication, social movements, and at the end of the day, most of these things are or need to be social movements. Social movements where we define society quite broadly or a planetary level and are able to build the kinds of relationships. I already see a lot of that happening. The issue is to ensure what I said earlier, that again, it does not become a platform for the elite. So how do we break that? How do we have people from other communities doing presentations in the next shift or the next environment day that might come, say, 1 week from now? So I think that those are the kinds of things that we need to look at. It might also be interesting to see where to kind of challenge people to speak about things that are not their ends of expertise or engagement. But for that you need safe spaces, because all of us are sort of whole varieties of issues, but then we need safe spaces. How do I understand, say, LGBTQ politics? How do I understand the issue of, the sensibilities of, let's say, an identity-based struggle in the Northeast or in Palestine? These are all things, we'll have conflicting views. And there needs to be, especially for young people, there needs to be safe spaces. Correctness is less important than honesty. And there is tolerance among people to engage in a spirit of exchange of ideas. Because a lot of us, I grew up with no idea. I grew up in a upper caste ghetto. And I studied in a central school, thinking that the country was an equitable place where all Indians were brothers and sisters and equal. And it was a very rude shock for me when I got out into the real world that was not the case. Fortunately, there were people who were not rude to me. They were able to kind of gently tell me that I was completely mistaken. And I had questions on a whole range of things that would seem politically incorrect. But as a young person, I think I have the right to ask and be, informed. So that space for collectives like yourselves would be very useful to cultivate.
I think that's a useful place to wrap up today's conversation. These kinds of things, like Riti mentioned, I think there are conjectures which come where the presence of channels or forces to go and make use of those conjectures or conjunctures will be absolutely necessary in the coming days, and particularly the oppressed and the dispossessed and the toiling people will have to be at the forefront of these struggles, not from elite places. And now when we are seeing more of these anti-systemic voices looking for alternatives, so you can also revisit some of the older struggles from the last century. Like when you were mentioning the kind of spaces that we need to develop, like I couldn't help but think about the politics of Sangharsh and Nirman, which the Chhattisgarh Mukti Morcha at one point used to champion, when a workers' union also linked hands with the peasantry, also had a separate environment wing, and also thought politically about each of these issues. So, developing those kinds of fighting organizations, and for the revolutionary students and youth to play a role in that, to join hands with that, will absolutely be necessary. And hopefully, in the coming days, we'll be able to engage in more such struggles, in more such conversations, and have more such absolutely great speakers like Nityanand Jayaraman, on behalf of Collective, and I think everyone in the audience here today, I'd like to thank you for your time and your wonderful presentation, and we hope that we can have more such conversations like this in the future.
Thank you.
All right. And also everyone who joined us today, thanks a lot for joining today's discussion. We look forward to having you again for more successions.